Good evening, everyone. In the last few weeks, I started a lecture question series, which is questions and answers, but it's common questions that we have every day, every week. And I see from what people ask over the years, this is more or less the same questions repeat themselves. Maybe after we finish this series, people will be able to get all their answers without calling and without wasting time. So yesterday in Brooklyn, I finished all kinds of questions about relationships, about modesty, Yetzer Hara, Gama Brit, all kinds of mental sicknesses that involve with these issues. We finished that chapter. Today I'm starting something different, which is Choshen U'Mishpat. One of the four parts of Shulchan Aruch is Choshen U'Mishpat. What does it mean, Choshen U'Mishpat? It means laws between men to men about money issues. All kinds of delegations when it comes to who owes who, people who found something, arguments about a lost object, arguments between neighbors, loans, interest, stealing, penalties, all these things. It's a large part of our life. We're going to discuss in the next few weeks. One thing we should know, many, many years ago, I asked a big tzaddik about taking someone to Beit Din. And I knew that if I go to Beit Din, for sure I win, because there was no question. All the paperwork was clear, the proofs. But it's a matter of standing with the kippah in front of judges and wait for the dayanim to decide who's going to get the money. So he told me, this is what he told me, this is an introduction before I start. He told me, someone who has real emunah in Hashem never goes to Beit Din to sue someone, which means if they call you, you have no choice, you have to go. But you take someone to Beit Din, if a person have real faith in Hashem, he'll never do it. So I ask him why. He say, because there are two options. One, you deserve the money. One, you don't deserve the money. If you deserve the money, then with or without Beit Din, Hashem will give you the money, because nobody lose what he deserve. If it won't happen now, it'll happen in 5 years. But it's your money. You must receive the money. When Hashem will decide, ואתה נותן להם את אוכלם ביתו. Maybe Hashem will put it aside 15 years when you have to marry your kids. You'll get that money. One way or the other, you must get the money. And if you don't deserve the money, even if you win in Beit Din, you will have to lose the money. So why wasting time? So I asked him, but Rabbi, half of the Gemara, not half, but a large portion of the Gemara, it's questions about Beit Din. Baba Batra, Baba Metzia, Baba Kama, other masachtot, you have parts in different masachtot that you have a large portion of the halacha in Shulchan Aruch, at least a quarter of Shulchan Aruch, it's Choshen U'Mishpat. It's matters between people, nezikin, money, issues, stealing, who owes who, loans, you know. So he told me the Torah gave the answer to all level of people. The Torah is not only for the righteous people and for the people who have high faith in Hashem. The Torah is even for the biggest losers. People who their level of emunah is 1%, the Torah needed to give the solution for this kind of people also. But it doesn't mean you have to be one of these losers. You understand what he said? Look how a clever chacham think. He say, yes, if two people who have 0 emunah in Hashem or 5% emunah in Hashem wants to kill each other, before they kill each other, you take them to Beit Din. And in a Beit Din, they'll make peace between them by decide who pays who and finish. For they're really going to get into murder. But people who have emunah in Hashem, they need to go to Beit Din, to sue, to fight, Lashon Hara. So I speak to all different kinds of levels. I mean, who do I know who listens to the lecture? Sometimes it's in a very high level, sometimes it's in a very low level. Most people are average. They have emunah in Hashem. They know it comes from Hashem. But if somebody owed them $100, they'll go to a World War III. So it's hard to understand. I mean, it's very difficult sometimes to define who has really emunah in Hashem. Why? Sometimes you find a person, he will bring you into his house, he will spend $1,000 to give to make you sheva brachol, he hardly knows you. He hardly say hello to you in a shul. He found out that they're looking for a place for chatan and kala to do sheva brachot. He volunteers. He brings food. His wife cook. They bring catering. No problem. Tomorrow somebody owe him $100. He's ready to send Tony to kill him. How does it work? How does someone who's willing to be so generous and do mitzvah l'shem shamayim, not for the chatan, he hardly knows him, but he heard his mitzvah to help chatan and kala, he's willing to jump to the fire for it. Tomorrow morning, the tenant, instead of giving him $1,500 rent, he only gave him $1,200. He told him, next month I'll give you the rest. He's ready to kill him. He calls the lawyer already. Listen, I'm tired of this tenant. And even if she's a widow, how does it work? I know a guy who was the biggest thief in the history of a town, without saying the name of the town. But he, at the same time, was the biggest machnis orchim in that town. Which means, any time you come to his house, there are guests there. No matter whether it's Shabbat, Yom Tov, Tuesday, Monday. Chamulot, you know chamulot? Bunches of people from Israel have no place to sleep. They go over there, they eat there, they sleep there, they swim in his pool. But every 2-3 weeks, you hear about a different victim that he sting. 20,000, 10,000, 50,000 check bounce, fake checks. Oh, people put money by him, they'll never see their money back. But at the same time, he feed everyone. His house is open, almost like the house of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih. How do you explain such a contradiction? Reality-wise, it's hard to explain, but if you know the secret of life, it's very easy to explain. Why? Because every person comes to this world with weaknesses from his previous life. There are certain things that a person did very well in his previous life. He does not have yetzer hara in this particular mitzvot or averot. He doesn't have yetzer hara. Or his yetzer hara is very small. Why? Because before he died in his different body, he was very good in that. So here we can find a situation of a person that when it came to be machnis orchim, he was already very good with that in his previous life. He has no yetzer hara not to allow people to come to his home and eat and enjoy everything there, no problem. He'll pay whatever it takes, no problem. But yosher, it's a different territory. In a business with a customer, tricking, cheating, selling them fake merchandise, not paying the bills, supplier every 3 months, no bankruptcy, no corporation, changing the sign, all these things that we see every day, this is something he did not fix in his previous life. So when he's born as a kid, he already have these weaknesses. Already in kindergarten, it's still candy. And then in elementary school, it's still the answer of the test from his Rebbe. And then later on, he robbed a little store. And then later on, he became made of. One way or the other, you know, it's the weakness exists right there. Same thing you can see by putting three different kids, that they behave different. Three, you can have a triplet. Person had, Baruch Hashem, a gift from Hashem. Triplet, three identical faces. You go to each one of them, 2 years old, and you see that each one of them has a different personality. One is very generous, one is very stingy, and one is average. A little bit of each. How do they know? Nobody ever taught them to be stingy or to be generous. They don't know about life. They don't know about what Hashem's going to give them, how difficult it is to get. What do you lose? What do you gain? They're only 2 years old. They cannot do the calculation. You see, it's already in the nature of the baby to be stingy. Or it's in the nature of the baby to be generous, even though it's clear to every normal person that nobody ever taught them how to behave. They don't know yet. They're born, they came to this world with this tchunot, with these traits. From somewhere, it did not come out of nowhere. The answer is very simple. A few years ago, he died. He was 70, 75, 80, whatever he was. He was standing in front of Hashem for mishpat, for a trial. Whatever he was good, it's good. Whatever he was bad, Hashem said to him, I'm sending you back in a new baby, no body, no place, maybe the same town, doesn't matter. Whatever you need to correct, we'll give you one more chance. So he comes with his weaknesses. That's why you need Bet Din. Because there are people who, you know, if you're not going to go by Bet Din, Chas v'shalom, who knows what can happen next. Plus, the Gemara say, Il male mora malchut, ish et achiv chaim blau. Forget about Bet Din. Bet Din, Baruch Hashem, it's a kosher institution, try to follow the laws of the Torah. But malchut, the goyim, the Romans, the Greeks, the Americans, really, no matter where you live, we have a lot of gratitude to the kingdom of the goyim where we live throughout history for one reason. If they wouldn't be around, people will kill each other nonstop for money, for kavod, for divorce issues, for all kinds of things. Why? People do not do it now because they're afraid of the police. You put the police one day on strike, 1 hour, not one day. You come to the police, you come on the television, you say that there's a strike of the police in New York State. How long is the strike? 1 hour. In 1 hour, we know if it's going to be 2 or 3 hours or it's going to finish in 1 hour. What would happen in that hour? They say on the television, and this hour, I am the governor of New York, I don't know his name, whatever his name is. Cuomo. So Cuomo used to be Cuomo many years ago. Ah, also here it's father and son, just like the mafia. So it's Cuomo. So Cuomo comes on the television and he said, you know, due to my rights as a governor, I announce right now New York State as a state without police for the next 60 minutes. Therefore, don't count on the police to bring anything to justice for this next 60 minutes until further notice, which means you can do whatever you want, no judgment. 60 minutes. What do you think would happen?
Sunday.
I'll tell you in one word. It will be the end of the world. Not the end of New York. Not the end of America. The end of the world. Why would be the end of the world? Why is such a fanatic answer? It's very simple, it will be the end of the world. You want to know how? People will begin to kill every enemy they have, no? There's many, many murderers out there that were not caught. They have a list of people they want to kill. Oh, now we can do it legally, with the camera, without the camera, no problem. You can rob banks, go with machine guns, all these gangs. Right now they work for years until they plan their robbery. They don't need now. They come inside, 15 people, machine guns, begin to shoot, to kill. They rob anything, they rob cars on the street, they get people out of their cars, they're stealing their Rolex, they're burning things, everyone kill his enemies, ex-boss, his ex-whatever, and all of a sudden, it's a war on the streets. In Los Angeles, remember what happened with the riots? How they robbed all the stores and the Korean people were getting beaten up by the blacks, and in Crown Heights, the blacks who hate the Chabadnikim, so they begin to shoot, and Crown Heights is on fire, and the next thing, they come to Williamsburg, and everybody, and the army, and nobody knows what's going on, and the stock market collapse, and it's affecting the whole world, and it's affecting all the stock markets. People begin to jump from buildings, and the next thing, two Russian people who lost all their money press the nuclear thing to shoot in the United States out of anger, and United States retaliate. And everyone jumped to the party, and the world is over. Like the Gaon Mivilna say, before Mashiach come, 9 minutes. And the world will be over. No? Somebody asked later in history, what caused the end of the world? Police, union, policemen decided to go on a strike in New York for 1 hour. No one would believe it. That's called in Hebrew, effect aparpar. You know what it means, effect aparpar? The butterfly effect. When you see a butterfly here in the room now, he moves his wings like this, right? You think to yourself, what does it do to the world? But the scientists prove or claim, I don't know exactly if they really proved it, but it's a famous thing, that this movement of the wings of this little butterfly to flyers right here affect the entire world. It goes from one side of the world to the other. one thing leads to another. We don't see the effect. But I give you another example. A person here has a Chinese landlord. And he didn't pay him rent for 2 months. Two checks bounced. And now the Chinese landlord owe money to the Chinese mafia in Beijing over there. He couldn't send them the money. So they killed his kids in China. They killed the kids. So the brother of this Chinese guy saw what they did to his nephews. He took a Chinese gang and they started to kill. And all of a sudden, hundreds of people are involved of shooting and killing and booming places. And then after all, it became a world war. And then they ask, what caused the world war? They say, Mr. Cohen bounced two checks to Mr. Lee, and that's what caused the end of the world. You understand? That's, by the way, the answer to the people who do not understand the pasuk, in Elo Yanum Velo Ishan Shomer Israel. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, every transaction in the world is under his supervision. If you're a guard, if you watch the international bank, Swiss bank, so you're the guard, you're watching the screens, you can't say that all year when you sit there, you see everything. There are things you don't see. You see what you need to see, but there are little things that you don't see. The bank is still around, the money is still there, everything is fine. You don't see every face, every person. You try to do as much as you can. By the HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if he missed one move in the world, one move, it would ruin the purpose of the creation. What does it mean? If I give you an example, one guy smacked his friend on his face. Let's assume for a minute that only this punch HaKadosh Baruch Hu did not see. It came out of his radar. Hypothetically speaking, why it's affecting the whole world. All the justice in the world now would get ruined. Why? Because it's one thing leads to another. It's a chain reaction. Right? Next thing, this person, you know, did something to him. And then if you miss one transaction in the middle, you can never judge, because remember, it's a chain reaction. It continued to travel forever and ever. 20 years later, it's still going on. One, he became an enemy of this guy. Tomorrow he wants to get elected, so he vote against him, so he didn't get elected. His children got upset, so they wanted to do something else. And all of a sudden, the way that the things travel, if Hashem would miss one little transaction, the entire justice system of the universe will all be not kosher anymore. That's the point here. If Hashem miss one transaction, any other tzedek, there's no more tzedek. Why? Because one thing leads to another. If in a court, if one thing, one little detail the judge is missing, the entire trial is not fair. It's almost impossible to reach justice in Beit Din. That's why today the Dayanim, they always push for settlement, that they'll make some kind of a settlement. Because the Dayanim know, if you really want to make a fair judgment, you have to be God. There's no way to do a fair judgment, 100%. Unless if it's a very easy case, you know, Reuven lend money to Shimon with two witnesses and he doesn't pay back. That's an easy case. I'm not talking about cases like this. I'm talking in business, between partners, between neighbors, who paid, why, what date, what. There's a lot of details here. I'll give you one example. Two people can make business in billions of dollars. Billions of dollars. Now they have a fight, two partners. One claim, I gave you money. And the other person said, what do you want from me? I got robbed with a gun to my head. So now the judge has to decide what kind of responsibility he had for the money. So $1 in a transaction changed the entire trial. $1. You have a billion-dollar argument. $1 will decide if he has to pay back the $1 billion or no. How? If the person who invested the money wrote in a contract, the mashkia gave the receiver $1 as sachar for his effort, one line. That's all. It changed the entire trial. The judge missed that $1. He would rule a tragedy. He took $1 billion out of a person illegally against the Torah. Do you know what an impact is going to make in the world? It changed the entire world. $1. Why the dollar changing it? He made him shomer sachar on the money. By giving him $1, that's enough. $1, you agree to receive $1 for your work? You made yourself liable for the money, even if people rob you. Before, you had a different kind of deen. This $1 changed the status. So this is just to give you an idea how every little detail in a justice affects the entire world. Now, it's not a joke. That's why one of the things the olam standing on is the deen. I wish the world was a perfect place, that everyone trusts Hashem, nobody hates anyone, and people know whatever they did to me, I leave it to Hashem. Ashlech ya'avcha al Hashem. Hashem, don't have time to stand in Bet Mishpat, lawyers, this, chilul Hashem, pictures, on the news. You know what they did. If I deserve the money, you'll give it back. I don't deserve it, please don't give it back. I don't want money, it's not mine. If everyone would have this kind of belief, a fantastic world it would be. Fantastic. You can leave everything in your backyard, you don't have to lock your home. Because you live in such a high level, you know, it doesn't matter if people take. Whatever is mine, nobody can touch. Problems today, we don't have emunah, that's why we need to do a lot of ishtadlut. We have to put bars and cameras and security. We must put, because we don't have emunah. Because we don't have emunah, Hashem look at us in such a low level that you have to act with ishtadlut. And if you had emunah, you never have to worry. You don't have to worry about marrying your children, you sit home, you relax. It wouldn't bother you. If the kid became 25, no problem, you smile as usual. He became 40, you smile as usual. He became 60, you're still smiling. Why? How can you smile? There's a boss to the world, it's his problem, not mine. Emunah, it's a wonderful thing. It takes away all the pain from you. Emunah, if a person knows that whatever Hashem does is for good, so why should I cry for? 99% of the things we cry for is because we don't even know if it's good or bad. Person gets fired from his job. He begins to cry, he begins to smoke like crazy, cannot eat, he's getting very nervous, he's very upset, he begins to scream in the house, he becomes very, very, you know, not comfortable to be around. If he only knew that this entire process would make him a billionaire in 2 years, will also behave like that? When will he know it? In 2 years from now. But until then, he killed himself. And one day, he gets a heart attack. For these 2 years, it was eating his heart. I give you an example of what I mean. One Hasid had a little kid handicapped on a wheelchair. And there's no bus that can take the kid with a wheelchair in Israel to the school, so the father needed to buy a car. I need to buy a car with a big trunk that he can fit the wheelchair inside. And this is an Avrech Kolel. To begin with, he's not rich. He's Avrech. So he went to a place where the, you know, used car sales over their garage there. And there are three partners, not religious guys. This is a true story. It really happened. So he came and he said, you know, I want to buy a car and I need it to put a wheelchair. So they right away saw a person that doesn't know anything about cars. And the guys were crooks over there. So they tried to get rid of bad cars. So they had a bad Volvo over there. Transmission is finished. The engine is almost finished. You know, it doesn't worth a penny. But they see this guy, what does he know from his life? So they put, you know, all kinds of special oil inside, all kinds of things to make the car drive another day or two. Just to get it out of the place and the yard, to get the money and... So now, one of the three partners, he was standing outside, so he saw the little kid in a wheelchair outside. So I told him, what are you doing here? He said, I came with my father to buy a car from you. My father is inside. So he said, oh, yeah. So now he knows they are actually tricking the father of this kid. But, you know, he has a heart of a Jew, even though he's going to make a few thousand dollars now for nothing, for a car who doesn't worth a penny. But his heart started, his conscience started to bother him. So he went back inside and he said to him, listen, Rabbi, why don't I show you other cars? Why you like this Volvo so much? We have other cars over here. These two other ones, they looked at him. Said, what are you confusing him? We gave him the best car here. He said, no, come, I'll show you. Did you see we have other cars? Maybe you'll find something you like better. Maybe nicer color. Maybe, you know, so you know, he gets confused, you know, he doesn't know anything about cars. Very naive. Standing over there, And they try to get the cash, begin to count the cash, and he tried to get him not to pay them the cash. And they get angry now. What are you pushing your nose now? So now when he saw that no matter what he does, he doesn't get the message, the Hasid. So he said to him, don't buy this car. This car is garbage. It doesn't worth a penny. There's no engine, no transmission. Don't buy it. Hasid picked up the money right away. Thank you very much. Hashem bless you. Took the money and ran away. Now, those two people were to get $7,000-$8,000 right now. They took the chair, broke it on his head, started to beat him up. Big fight inside. What happened when three criminals fight? They go to the head of the mafia, what we call in Israel a borer, the borer. The borer, he has to decide if they did it, what they did. So the borer decided, chukes dom. That's what he decided, that he has to lose his third right away. Plus, he has to pay each one of them. He has to pay them a third and a third from his own pocket. So if it was $9,000, he has to give $3,000 to each one of them, and he lost from his own pocket. But not only that, he cannot be a partner in a business now. So he evicted him from the business with no rights. That's it. He lost his parnassah. Now he comes home, he tells his wife the story. Now remember, this is two secular people. No, they don't learn yeshiva, they don't learn musar. Two complete secular people. He comes and says to his wife, you know, the story. So his wife told him, Tov me'od, I'm very proud of you. Lo stam de gemara say, mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav, even by the secular people. Mezavgim lo lefi ma'asav, because it's different levels. So his wife right away supported him, said, kol ha'kavod, very good. You did the right thing. What kind of a person has no heart to sell a handicapped boy, a car that will die tomorrow on the road. I'm 100% behind you. Whatever happened, happened. Now he's looking for a job. How long? If you think it's hard to find a job here, think again. Multiply it by 10. 1.5 years he's looking for a job, he cannot find a job. The little money he saved, all of it is gone. He got up to here, they cannot find a job. So he started to have a second thought, so maybe I made a mistake. Why did I push my nose? So his wife told him, no, I still think you did the right thing. One day you see an ad that, you know, he's gonna go to a place and they're looking for a mechanic for a bus company. Religious people, they own bus company, private. They're looking for a good mechanic. So they make interviews. They have the board, 12 members of the board of the company. And all the people who wants to get the job, they have to come and they have in a, you know, a little short interview in front of them. So he came, he see maybe 60 mechanics came. What is his chance to get the job? Hey, listen, I'm already here. Finally, they call his name, he come inside, they look at his resume. All these religious people say, you didn't even work like mechanic. Most of your life you used to be a, you know, used car salesman. We're looking for someone who worked 20, 30 years, you know, like he has experience, and especially with buses. Okay, listen, we'll let you know. So you already get the point. He wasted his time. He went out, he went downstairs, then a little kid ran after him. Excuse me, you were upstairs for an interview? He said, yes, come. They wanted to ask you one more question, they forgot. I'm thinking to himself, what is this Hasidim now wasting my time now? He wants to ask me another question. What am I, to go, not to go? You know, when a person is so desperate, he said, I'm already here. Let's see what the chutzpah they have. They want to ask me another question. He came back inside. Then one of them said, excuse me, you used to have a place in this and this place in an auto car salesman? You used to own it? He said, yes. He said, you don't remember me? He said, oh, all of you look the same to me. So he said to him, about 2 years ago I came to buy a car from you and you saved me from your two partners, the crooks. He looks at me and says, I'm the father of the boy. He didn't see that. He used to be in Avrech in Kolen, now he's sitting in a board in this camp. So he said to him, you got the job. And we're looking for someone like you. So he got the job. After a few years, became a rich guy. It was a very good job. They made him supervisor. In the long run, nobody ever lost from doing the right thing. The only problem is that Hashem is playing with us. He's stretching the salvation. Let's see how strong and how much emunah you will have. The longer we wait, the weaker the emunah become, no? Right? Some people, after a few years of looking for a good job, they give up already. Whatever happened, happened. They lost emunah. I won't find. Same thing, shiduchim. There are people who went on many shiduchim, didn't work out, they don't want anymore. No, forget it. What do you mean? I'll die single. I don't want to go on dates anymore. I had it. Agree with the decree. That's not what Hashem wants. Hashem tests a person. A person has to go all the way with this Be'ezrat Hashem Emunah. Now, we're going to go start some questions and answers. We know many people, unfortunately, have attraction to gambling. They gamble. But there's different kinds of gambling. There's gambling in a casino. There's gambling between friends, playing cards, playing. They're gambling in sport, who's going to win, predicting the future. There's different kinds of gambling. Playing with dice. When the Gemara speaks about a gambler, the Gemara calls it Mesachek Vekubia. Right away, an Israeli guy think, play Sheshbesh. Mesachek Vekubia, what else you do with a Kubia? But in reality, is that what Chazal meant? Only someone who throw dice? Someone who play on cards is not a gambler? Or someone that they make a race between two roosters. You know how they used to do. You put your money on this one and this one. You give them some food over there in the end of the room. And whoever gets to the end first, he makes all the money. Like they do in OTB today. Horse racing. They used to do it with chickens or different animals. Or fights between two dogs. Who's going to kill who? He puts his money on the black. He puts his money on the white. The question is, there's any nafkamina, any difference between the gamblers or the concept, once you're already counting on gambling, you automatically pasul le'edut. Because the chachamim say, "Meshachek bekubiya," someone who gamble on a dice, is pasul le'edut. Why is pasul le'edut? Pasul le'edut means he cannot be a witness. Cannot be a witness. Why? What's the connection? He has his businesses, he has his job, and he likes to go hobby. Sachek bekubia, he loses $1,000 a month. He make a million, he loses $1,000. What's the big deal? He can afford it. That's his fun. He's Amaret, Torah he doesn't learn. What's the difference if he sit and watch Kaduregel, football, or if he plays Sheshbesh for a little money? We're not talking necessarily someone that put millions of dollars and owe money and he loses his home and his children are on the street. Okay, we understand. We're talking even, you play on $5, $10 between friends. So the question is, someone like that is considered pasul le'edut? The answer, lo be'yamenu, not in our days. What changed? Rav Ovadia Yosef wrote an answer about it in Shut Yabia Omer Zayin Choshen Umishpat Vav. Well, it's in other poskim. What changed between the old days to our days and someone who's Mesachek Bekubia? What was the concept that the Chachamim say something, someone like that Pasul Le'edut? What? The answer is, when you play with your friend and you make money in gambling, the friend that pays you the money never mochel for the money. In his heart, he's still tied to that money. Why? The only reason he gambled is was sure he's going to win. You know how the gamblers are. This time for sure I win. Until they lose everything. Therefore, the only reason he played is on the machshava of winning. But when he loses, he doesn't pay like when you buy a product. You come to a store, you buy milk, you buy whatever you buy, grocery, you give him $50, you're happy to give him the money, he deserves it. You bought grocery, you take what you deserve, I take what I have, goodbye. You give the money with left off. But when your friend made in a card game or kubiya, he took away from you $100, even if you make millions, You're not giving up this $100 by Lev Shalem. And I saw it in my own eyes. I saw two very wealthy guys in real estate. They happen to be brothers. That they play for $100, $200 for the fun. It's nothing for them. They make millions. And after months, they continue to argue about those games. That's how much it bothers them. They spend $100 a minute. They don't care how much they spend. They buy the same. But that particular one, there's no mechila. So what changed today? What changed today? The fact is that people are not even aware. They're not aware that it's stealing. Ask any gambler between friends that play. Do you think you did gezel? Gezel? Why gezel? So you just won from your friend's money. Sure, I won. I didn't steal it. But it's gezel. Chachamim say it's gezel. But most of the people have no idea. Have no idea what they're doing. So if the people have no idea, I changed the law. Why it will change the law? I don't understand. Huh? We have to see in Yabi Omer, why Chacham Ovadia say, Be'amenu, it's not somebody like this. So the answer is, briefly, later you can see over there, the answer is, it's not that it's not Gezel. It's still Gezel even if you don't know. But it doesn't make you pasul le'edut. When you know you're stealing and you continue to do it, that's a different story. How can we rely on you in Beit Din? You're not a reliable person. But if you're such an amaret, such an ignorant, that you didn't even know that by winning in gambling, it's become an issue of gezel, you have no idea. It doesn't make you a bad person. You're not a crook. You have no idea that you did something wrong because the people today have no idea that something is wrong about it. Ask, take 1,000 Jews that gamble between their friends, and tell them, tell me, did it ever occur to you that you're stealing money from your friends when you win? Not one would say yes. It didn't even cross his mind. Yeah, you agree with me or no? That's the difference. But in the old days, they knew. Everybody knew, and they still did it. We cannot rely on you to be a witness. What about...
It's a casino.
Poker. Cards. They play poker also for little money. $10, $15. Maximum $50 you lose once a week. Not the end of the world. Can he be a witness, someone like that, or not?
No.
The answer, yes.
Yes?
For the same reason. For the same reason. Now, when we give a loan from between one Jew to another, do we need... one witness, it's enough to see that the cash go from hand to hand? Or we still need, besides that witness, to make a contract? Your friend came, he wants to borrow $100. You're not allowed to give cash from hand to hand without witnesses. You need at least one witness. So now, the question is, one witness is enough, or you still need some kind of a document that the witness would sign on the document? Oh, it's enough that he saw in his eyes. Reuven, come. I'm giving this guy Shimon $100 loan. Remember the date. If anything, there's going to be a problem. You just saw that I'm giving him the money. Or you have to make a document, and when he gives you back the money, you must give him the document that he ripped it. What do you think? So now if a person wants to borrow $10 to buy a pack of cigarettes, I have to make an agreement to call the lawyer, come, be a witness, bring the notary. I'm asking, what did the Torah mean? The Torah says you need shtar and edim. But if somebody wants to borrow $20, now every time someone wants to borrow $20, you're going to call someone to make a shtar. What are you going to do? So if it's a check, there's no question. You don't even need one witness because the check, it's an actual proof. If you give it by check, it's no problem. But cash transaction must have at least one witness. Better two, but one minimum. But the point now, do you need to make a shtar? The answer, if it's a small amount, that worse comes to all people are mochel, you don't need. But if it's a serious amount, you must do shtar and edim, and the more you protect yourself, the more you helping the other person to win against his Yetzer Hara. Let me explain. Sometimes you give money to an honest person. You give him money, honest person. Nobody knows that he never stole. There's no record of him. You give him a lot of money in cash between you and him alone. No camera, no nothing. What happened after that? Even if he's an honest person, the Yetzer Hara begin to drill in his head. It's an opportunity to get you out of your misery. Nobody saw. One time you do Avera. You can do tshuva one day. Take the money, invest it, open a business, be successful. 2 years later, come, give him the money, kiss him on his head. Moshe, I apologize, forgive me. Here is your money. You'll be clean. You'll do tshuva. Bemakom shebaale tshuva omdim, en tzadikim gmorim omdim. And you marry, you become a millionaire. But if there are witnesses, the Yetzer Hara cannot fool him. Why? He cannot go around. The witnesses, the shtar. That's why it's you give money to a person without witnesses or without shtar, it's a sin. Lifnei iver lo titen michshol. Lifnei iver lo titen michshol. Lifnei iver lo titen michshol. Is it sur d'oraita or d'rabanan? D'oraita. It's like eating chazir. Imagine what a scenario. A friend, some poor guy comes to you, Moshe, help me out, I'm in a big problem. How much you need? I need $1,000. Take out $1,000 bill, you give it to him. No witnesses, no shtar, no nothing. Chazaku Baruch, Hashem will help you. Give me when you have. What a tzaddik you are. What a good heart. It counts you ate chazir that moment. Ignorance is the biggest enemy of the human being. That's what the Gemara says, Ena Ma'aretz Chassid.
What happened if you give somebody gave you $100,000, signed for you a witness, not two, 10 witnesses? You don't have to return your money. You took your bedin. What bedin going to do? They can force you, they have no money.
You're right. Today the bedin doesn't have the power they used to have. In the old days, people were, when, as soon as they hear bedin call them, they faint. First of all, from the embarrassment in a community, because everyone was religious, so the Bedin was the top authority. Second, the Bedin had police. What do you think? You don't pay, they come, they take away everything you have. Not like in America, they give you a compliment and put you on television. You know, they make a show about you. Or make you Haver Knesset. It's a very good shortcut. In the old days, if your reputation come in a community that Bedin called you, the Gemara say in Bava Metzia, the Gemara say, Reuven gave Shimon something to keep, a cow. Keep me the cow, I go to Israel, I come back in a month, I'll take back my cow, watch my cow. He came back after a month, this is a Perek Shlishin Bava Metzia, Mafkid. He came back after 3 months, and you see the cow was stolen. He came back after a month, the cow was stolen. So now, Reuven, that was watching the cow for Shimon, is Shomer Chinam. He didn't get paid for it. So what's the law? Shomer Chinam, all he has to do is to swear there was no negligence, and he doesn't have to. It's patur. What does it mean, no negligence? That he watched the cow like he watched himself. He locked her, and the lock was locked, you know, and it was in a safe place, not out of nowhere. Everything that's supposed to be good shmira, if you did, and somebody came with a truck and broke the fence and stole the cow, what can you do? It would happen to your own cow. So the Gemara say, if he wanted to pay, he doesn't have to swear. But he doesn't have to pay. It's dismissed. He doesn't have to pay. But if he wants to pay, ratza shilem velo nishba, he doesn't want to swear, so he paid. So the question is, who's going to be the fool that he, according to the law, is not guilty, that he volunteered to pay for a cow? Cow in our days is $5,000. So if I watch my friend the cow and people came and robbed it, I have to pay him $5,000? No. The Torah say no. Why would I pay $5,000? Why? From the embarrassment to show your face in Beit Din. Even you're 100% right, already the rumors will begin. You heard? The Beit Din called him. Tomorrow you have to marry your children. There's already a mark in your file. That's how it was. Today, the maximum Beit Din can do is find him guilty. And then they tell him to pay. And if he doesn't pay, the rumor begins to go. If this is a person that is religious, he won't want to take the risk. Because remember, in a religious, ultra-Orthodox community, there are things that are more important than money. It's the reputation. Why? You can have billions of dollars, but if your reputation is ruined, nobody wants to marry you. Nobody wants anything to do with you. It messed up the whole family. So sometimes a person would pay a lot of money if there is a secret about him. He'll pay a lot of money that the secret will not come out. Why is it? Because the reputation is very important. By the not religious world, reputation is important, but it's not the end of the world. Big deal. So they put in a newspaper that I'm a thief. But in the meantime, I took $1 million. Let them put. By the Haredim, it's much, much more severe, even though unfortunately it's changing now. Now already there's no more busha in this generation. But at least that's how it was for 2,000 years. If the guy doesn't come to Beit Din, then they give you permission to take him to court. And then, you know, you go to the regular procedure, the court, police, marshal, sheriff, and all these things. Then, next thing. A person owes me money and he does not pay me, and I know he has the money. I know he has the money. Can I call him to ask for the money, or send him a hint, or send him a messenger? Or I'm violating the rule of the Torah, lo tigos. The Torah say, if you lend money to someone, you're not allowed to go and ask for the money back. Which means, even if you see him, you have to run away and that he won't get embarrassed. He won't be embarrassed. The question is, what did the Torah mean? So now I gave a loan, that's it, I lost the money, and I have to sit and wait until this tzaddik will come one day with the money? And I allowed after a year to remind him, hey, it's a due date. The due date is passed. What's going on? So what the Torah meant, only if it's ani, someone who doesn't have the money to return, then you're not allowed to embarrass him because he doesn't have. It's not that he's a criminal, he doesn't have. Even if you go to his home to collect your collateral, you're not allowed to go inside, the Torah say. Clearly, you have to stand outside. There's rules. But if you know for sure that this person has money, you're allowed to demand for him to pay you the money. Right? You can see it in Sefer HaChinuch, Taf Ayin Vav, Taf Ayin Zayin. That's the source. There's other sources. My question is, there's a Gemara, the famous Gemara that they said that it was Rabbi Akiva, that a worker, he worked for a Balabait, and after the holidays came, and he went, and after a while, he came to collect his money, and he said, I don't have. So he told him, you know, give me maybe some land, so I don't have. Give me cows, some animals, I don't have. Give me pillows, I don't have. Everything he asked from him, I don't have, I don't have, I don't have. And you know, it's my boss is a wealthy guy. What does it mean you don't have? You live in a nice house, you have nice cars, you have cows, you have, you know, whatever you have. And everything I say you don't have, you don't have to pay for what I work. So after the holiday, the boss showed up with some donkeys full of everything, candy, food, all kinds of things with the money. And he said, here is your money. And he gave him a gift. Everything was nice. So he told him, let me ask you a question. The boss asked the worker, when you told me, give me my money, and I say, I don't have, what did you think? He said, I thought maybe your money was mortgaged. Maybe you gave it as collateral for a deal that you're doing. He said, when I told you I don't have, you asked me, okay, give me land instead of money. I'll sell the land, I get my money, a little piece of land. I told you I don't have, and you know I have. So he said to him, I thought maybe you mortgaged it. Maybe you gave it and somebody puts a lien on it and you, okay. When I told you I don't have, you know, everything, animals, maybe the maser, or everything, he gave him an answer. So he said to him, the rich, this is exactly what happened. You're right. All this assumption, you danoti lekaf schut, you judge me for favorably to the positive side. So you're right. This is what happened. This was mortgage and this and this was that. So ashrecha that you didn't suspect me. And the Gemara give a few more examples of somebody who took a woman and she slept in his room and he asked the student, what do you think about me? All kinds of things like this. Conclusion, the Gemara say, you must judge your friend lekaf schut. That's a well-known thing. אסור לדון אדם לקו חובה. החושד בקשרים לוקה בגופו. If you suspect someone is not guilty, חס ושלום, you're risking your body, your health. So in that case, how do you know if he has the money? Just because he drives a Mercedes doesn't mean he has the money. I know people who have Mercedes, they don't have money to put gas. Literally, I know people like this. They bought it for the show off, and they cannot afford to pay gas on tolls. They leave it, most of the time it stands. So now if you think, oh, what kind of a rich guy he is. You see he has a very expensive watch, maybe it's fake. Today in Chinatown they sell the best fake watches, $15. That's how it was 20 years ago, maybe today 30. Perfect imitation. Very hard to know. Now what else? More, he has a house, beautiful house. How do you know? Maybe he has two mortgages on it. I have a friend, he lives in a beautiful house in Muncie. He has two mortgages. What he owed the bank is about $200,000 more than what the house worth. It looks like a very nice home. It's very hard to know if a person has. So what does it mean if he knows? There's always a doubt. You can never know for sure. No, how do you know? I said there are ways to know. How? There's one way for sure to know. If the person buy aliyot in a shul, 5,000. My 5,000, pay me my money, you fool. 5,000. Say, no, you don't understand. I'm giving 5,000, I'm trusting Hashem that he will give me the money to pay. And that's gula for parnasah to give tzedakah. No, my friend. Giving tzedakah when you owe money to people, it's not mitzvah, it's a crime. First, you must pay what you owe. After that, you think about tzedakah. Everything is the opposite today. You owe money to people? If you want to give tzedakah, you have to tell the noshim, you have to tell him, my friend, I want to donate to Sefer Torah with your permission. I will delay the schedule of payments until I pay you back your money. Are you mochel or no? Say, no, my friend, I want my money, I need the money. You cannot give to the Sefer Torah. You don't have permission. You owe money. The date is due. Malin, you malin at a kesef of someone. This person sit home and cry every day. He may ruin his life. You don't know. He made him shalom bayit issues. And you're the generous guy. I want to build a shul. First pay the $3 million you owe people in a business. No, I want to build a shul for the memory of my father. What memory your father have? It's going to make his situation a lot worse. That his son is such a crook. But his son built a shul. But with whose money? With Itzik, Moshe, Avi, and Avner? With whose money he built the shul? Everything, the people, they don't use their head. Everyone thinks they can fool Hashem. So it says like this. Someone owe me money and refuse to pay back. I am able to take it back from him with koach or by stealing from him. Am I allowed or not? He owe me $100,000. I know a way that I can get 70 out of him. At least minimize my damage. But in an illegal way. I can break into his business and get it from the safe. I know I left certain things in a car one day of the week. Or somebody told me on what bank account he hides it. And I have access, I can go, I have a hacker, he's going to go into his account and wire the money out. Tricky ways. But not to steal from him, just to take what he owes me, allowed or not allowed. The Gemara say, Ben Bagbag, was a big chacham, Ben Bagbag. עושה אדם דין לעצמו. במחלוקת between the חכמים, what does it mean? If it came to your hand naturally, then everyone agree you can keep it. In other words, Reuven owe you $1,000 and refuse to pay 1 year, 3 years, 5 years. One day, somebody say, where do you live? I live in this town. Oh, do you know this guy, Reuven? Yeah. Can you do me a favor? I owe him $1,000. Can you be a messenger and give it to him? Yeah, of course. Give me the money, I'll give it to him. You take the money, you keep it, you call him Reuven, you don't know me anymore. Allowed or not allowed? Everyone agree allowed. Your money. He owes you the money. Baruch Hashem. Hashem send you back your money. The question now, the argument is, if you're allowed to come into his house, push him, walk into the living room, take a beautiful vase, $5,000, get it out of his home, sell it, and give him back the change. You're allowed or not allowed? The answer, unfortunately, not allowed. But if he sits in front of you and he puts his iPhone here on the table, and it's worth, I heard today, they told me the new one costs how much, $600? So he just bought it yesterday and put it on the table and he owes you money. You grab it and you run away. Take it from what you owe me. No problem. But Makot, not allowed. Even though I heard, I don't want to say the name, one big Talmid Chacham, that somebody owes some money to someone, and he was able to get, you know, the big Vladimirs with the tattoos, and they come and you see him and you get a heart attack. And Vladimir told him, it's not the question if I can get the money or not. The question if you will stay alive or not. And he asked the big rabbi if he's allowed, and he said, it's allowed. You go with him. Not only that, it's a question, if it's allowed in Yom Tov to take two Vladimirs and they sit next to him in a shul in front of the whole community, two gorillas, like this. The Gvir comes to the shul with his beautiful suit, two Vladimirs walks next to him. What happened, Moshe, you got the bodyguards? No, Hashem will save me from these two bulldogs. Allowed or not allowed? They asked the Ben Ishchai this question. Huh? Allowed. Allowed. You're allowed to get your money back. The only argument is if you're allowed to punch him yourself or not. There's some opinion even that is allowed. But I didn't come here to teach violence, of course. So. I found in my house a book that I borrowed from my friends years ago and I forgot to return it. Do I have to return it and pay him penalty, for instance, you know, maybe all these years he had aggravation, didn't have the book, so maybe I'll give him $20 to make it up as a, you know, pitzuim for the damage I caused him or no? The answer, send it back with a letter of apology. No money. Why no money? Because it becomes interest. You borrow something, you give it with interest, it's not allowed. I have a neighbor, she keeps borrowing flour and milk and eggs or vegetables, and she never returned. Next time she comes, am I obligated to continue to give her, or I can tell her you're not returning, so I don't want to give you? It happens sometimes. Not necessarily neighbor, it could be at work. Give me a cigarette. You know these people who never buy cigarettes? You have cigarette for me? Have 20 years he lives off people's cigarettes. Or he killed himself from people's cigarettes. Depends how you want to call it. Allowed or not allowed? The answer, you don't have to give them anymore. You don't have to insult them, but you tell them, I'm sorry, I cannot give you. When I got a change in a store, one of the coins were fake. Am I allowed to continue to pass it on? Or it came to me, that means I'm the one who has to lose it. Because this coin can go forever and ever. Like in the old days, the Canadian money was not so much like the American. The Canadian dollar looks exactly like American. So if somebody gave you a Canadian dollar in the old days, it was half of American. But you can go and give it. And people in a store, you give 4 quarters, no problem. It's already went into the system. Today it's the same, more or less the same. There's really no nafkamina so much. Sometimes it's even more. But in a time that you know now, oh, now I know it's Canadian, how would I continue to pass it on? I'm tricking the people. Stealing even pruta, it's not allowed. Pruta in our days, it's nickel. Less than that, people mochel. Now, but nickel already has a value. If someone sees that you stole nickel from his pocket, he get upset. If you see you stole cent, maybe not from a pocket, because in a pocket everyone gets upset from the chutzpah. But you know, you have on the floor of your car, and you saw you gave a ride to someone, and there was a penny on the floor, and he picked it up and went with that. You're not gonna run after him. In my opinion, even a penny and a nickel, no one would run after him, and even a quarter, no one would run after him. But on a nickel, for sure, people mochel. But the question over here now, are you allowed to pass it on or no? The answer, not allowed to use it because it's gezel. Now you will get the mitzvah. Oh, just say gezel, the light went off. So they asked this question to Rav Eliashiv. And the answer, Rav Eliashiv say, is damna lecha mitzvah lo la'avor al gezel.
No.
Lo la'avor al gezel. Yesterday in my shiur, I asked the question. If a person has an opportunity to make a scene, and he sits and he does not do it, he has big yetzer hara to go to some party now. And he sits and he doesn't do it. So, does he get reward for sitting, still doing nothing? Or he only gets saved from the huge punishment he would get if you go to that mixed party? Sitting still and fighting your yetzer hara not to go and make a scene. Do you get reward? It brings you income or it saves you from loss?
No.
Good question, no? Did you ever think about this question before? Such a question that is nafkamina to every hour of our life. Person would live here 80 years and he doesn't know the answer to such an important question. The answer, he gets a reward for it. By winning the Yetzer Hara in any possible way, lefum tzara agra. The tzar, the sorrow, that the sacrifice, this desire, for the sake of heaven, l'shem shamayim, already bring your reward. Because we're lucky that Hashem is giving us reward not based on our achievement, based on our efforts and sorrow. How much you invested, how much pain. Based on that is most of the reward. If Hashem would only give us when we're successful, we would have nothing, basically. What did we succeed in? Did we succeed in our learning? No. Did we succeed 100% in chesed? No. What did we succeed in? Most of the things we do, we're not finishing. We either do half, we do a quarter, we do nothing. But Hashem takes all the efforts together and He gives us sachar for it, even if we fail. Even Ratzah, the Gemara says, Ratzah la'asot mitzvah v'ne'enas, ma'aleh alav ki'ilu asa. Person came to do a mitzvah and someone a minute later, before you went and did it. You were on the way to do it. And he went and did it, it count like you did it. Him and you, both of you get sachar for doing it. Why? This is the mercy of Hashem. Anus rachmana patre. You wanted to do, and Hashem knows for sure you're on the way to do it, and for whatever reason you couldn't do it, you get the sachar like you did it. Or a poor person is sitting in a shul when they raise money for something important, is dying to give, but he doesn't have. So he really, Hashem sees the pain that he has and the wish that he has, and gives him sachar for it. It's very interesting. Nowhere else you get sachar for sitting doing nothing. I always say when I give lectures about Shabbat to the people who does not keep Shabbat, I say, where else do you find such a beautiful religion? You sit home, you eat steaks, you drink good scotch, you have beautiful dessert, you snore. You come to gather all your friends together in a club. You listen to the beautiful singing of the chazan. Then you eat again, and then you go and you snore again, and you get a huge reward. Where do you find such a thing? And you don't want to do it. Think about it. No, that's what Shabbat is, no? And if you learn, it's even better. Now you enjoy the action of learning. It's beautiful. Now, next question. I like to buy coffee and to work on my laptop in a coffee shop and have free internet there. How long can I sit there because I only bought one cup of coffee for $3? Do I have to sit there until I finish the coffee? Or I can sit there 10 hours and do all my work using, because they give public internet there in a coffee shop. Everybody understands that the owners of the coffee shop offer this internet as a tool to attract customers to come buy coffee. If you ask him when you buy the coffee, I'm buying this coffee in a condition that I sit here 10, I'll be a settler here, mitnachel. I own this chair for the rest of my life. For this, I will probably throw you out of the window, right? So the question is, you allowed to sit there or not? Since, listen, you gave it, you did not write rules, I take advantage on a loophole in your law. Why not? I didn't do anything against the law. Oh, we have a rule, man desane alech, al ta'aseh lechaverach. What you don't want people to do to you, don't do to others. That's, by the way, the meaning of ve'afta le'reacha kamocha. When the Torah says ve'afta le'reacha kamocha, Hashem did not mean that you have to love your Jewish neighbor or somebody from the area, just like you love yourself the same level. It's not realistic. It never happened, and it will never happen. Person love himself, person love his children more than the children of the neighbor. It's perfectly normal. But what? They ask in the Gemara, what's ve'afta le'reacha kamocha? The answer, what you hate people doing to you, don't dare to do to others. Fair enough, no? Yeah. Okay. So the question right now, allowed or not allowed? The answer is, depend if people need the chair for business or not. If the place is full, all the chairs are there, already taken, and now you're sitting and sitting and sitting, you make the owner of the place lose money. That's already, even though it's grama, that's already an avera from the Torah. However, if it's half empty, 5, 6 people and have 100 chairs there, what did he lose? That's not that he's paying extra for the internet. It's called ze ne'ene veze eno chaser. Once you enjoy from someone, however, if you take internet from one of the neighbors without permission, that's not ze ne'ene veze eno chaser, because it's slowing him down.
Electricity in Starbucks, you charge your laptop.
That doesn't cost anything. All day you connect your laptop in Starbucks, it's not even a penny. That's the problem in electricity. People don't know the real value of it. The only thing that costs electric is engines, air condition, laundry machine, things that have motor that you have to constantly push it. Or light bulbs with very, very high voltage, like 300 or 500, they take a lot of electric. But chargers or phone, all month it will be connected, it won't be a dollar. I one time left an apartment empty, the whole month the fridge is working all month, it wasn't even $20, the whole month. Sometimes I go to places, it can be shul, it can be people's for Shabbat, and they try to save on electric by making everybody sweat on the air condition on Shabbat. Everyone with handkerchiefs like this. And I'm thinking to myself, what foolish decision. $5 more, everyone would enjoy the place. For $5 more, the entire Shabbat. You put the air condition on 65, in the hottest day, people come and they enjoy. Wow, nobody sweats, everyone stay clean. It will cost you $5 more. That's the difference between trying to save. It's not that much money. Overall, if you look at the final bill, you got $500. Divided to 31 days, the whole day. Put all month the air condition on. Laundry, washer, dryer, refrigerators, freezer. How much an average bill comes? 500, 400, 600? That's more or less what it comes. How much is a day? Not even $20. And that's with the AC automatically on. So how much is saving? $5 and every 500 people has to suffer now? And this person, if you come and tell him, do you know after you made everyone suffer, you saved $5. He would feel the biggest fool in the history. What a fool I am, burning money on all kinds of nonsense. And here I go and I save $5. Now, (laughs) Sometimes when they ask for help or chesed, my good heart always let me volunteer. I don't say anything, but I accept in my heart to go and do it. They say we need tomorrow people to volunteer, to come to Netz Minyan, 4:45 in the morning. They sit over their shiva. They decided to pray Netz, so they need Minyan. And the rabbi announced that he's thinking, okay, I'm going to go and do chesed. After an hour, the Yetzer Hara begin to work. And they say, well, they're going to get up at 4, all day will be tired. With all due respect, fine, they sit shiva. Let them do minyan at 8. Why do they have to make everyone suffer? The Yetzer Hara, you know. He cools you off. The question is that considered a neder or not? Is it considered a neder or not? If you had in mind to do mitzvah, it's called gamar bedaato to do mitzvah. So we know the rule. If the rule is that you accepted to give tzedakah be kabbalah gmura, not that you had it in mind, that you say, "Hare ani mekabel alai to give tzedakah to this talmid chacham," you must give him the money, not a penny less. It's a neder gamur. You must give it to him. The question is ordinary mitzvot. We need someone to help clean the shul tomorrow. You think in your heart, "I'm gonna come and clean." Then later on, you had somebody offered you something more interesting to do. You want to change your mind now. Are you obligated or not? Tvarim shebalev. Obligates you or not? The answer is, I'll ask another question, then I answer both of them. Reuven goes away for Rosh Hashanah Kippur, and he bought a chair from the shul. Now, somebody found out that he's going away, so you want to buy the chair from him. Can you give me your seat? You have a good location in the shul. So it's if Reuven agreed in his mind to sell him the chair for $20, let's say, and he offered him, before Reuven said the price, Reuven had in mind, if he'll offer me 20, I'll sell it. And then he said, "I'll give you 30 for it." He offered him more. Does he have to sell it to him for 20, what he had in mind? Or since he's the first one who opened his mouth and suggested to pay 30, I might as well enjoy from his foolishness. Min ha-din, there is a din, there is lifni mishurat ha-din. What's the minimum requirements? You're allowed to take whatever he offer. You didn't steal, you didn't say anything. He offer more. No, too good, Baruch Hashem. But it's midat chasidut. If you tell him, "I had in mind to charge you only 20, 30, it's too much. I'll give it to you for 20. That's a very big thing. And it's also show about big emunah in Hashem. The Gemara brings a few stories about some of their chachamim that they used to do it. And one of them was a goy, Dama ben Natina. Dama ben Natina, his father was sleeping on a jewelry, and the gizbar from Bet HaMikdash came to buy a yashfe. The Shevet Binyamin, the stone fell from the choshen of the Kohen. They need exactly the same stone. It's big stones worth millions in our days. They go, and, oh, they said, "This Dama ben Natina, this goy, he has this kind of diamonds, this kind of avnechen." I went over there, told him how much, says, gave him a price, shne zubim, whatever. He went upstairs, he came by, he said, and got so nervous that he said, "No, we'll give you 3. No, no, 4. No, 8. 10. He got it. 1,000. He said, no, "I'm sorry, I can't sell it to you." Next day, they doubled the amount. They came with a big sack of things, they put it all. Don't say no, give us the stone. So he said, no, I want only what I ask you in first place, Toda. Thank you very much. I only want what I ask you in first place. But why? We offer you 50 times more. It was midat chasidut. What happened to him? He had a red cow. Think about, let's say a goy from Texas today, wake up in his barn, and he see a new calf born, completely red. Red, like red brownish, para aduma. And if he knows the importance of Para Aduma to the Jews, maybe we should get it out of the video. I have listeners in Texas. If he finds out, he can ask any amount of money. We will have to pay it. Why? Where are you going to get another Para Aduma? We had already 9 in the history. We're waiting for the 10th one. If now we're going to have a red, pure Para Aduma, asher lo ala aleha ol, we have in Masoret, that's it. That's our chance now to get it. Now, if he's a businessman, he's going to tell us $1 billion for the cow. Do we have a choice? We're going to start have to go from one place to another and collect. We give him a down payment. So every month we'll give you, make a contract, we'll pay you in 20 years. I would do what I would do to him. I said to him, hey, Vinny. No, in Texas, there's no Vinny's. Hey, John, I have a great offer for you. But you give us the red cow, we won't give you $1 billion. We'll give you $10 billion, but in 5 years. And Mashiach come, the Rambam writes, you ma'adanim ke'afar. First of all, John would not be left, most likely. Because if he's a Christian, he's an idol worshiper, the Mashiach will clean them from the world. The Midrash said that all the Batei Avodah Zarah will be vacuum like Korach and Adato. It will suck them into the ground. They'll disappear from the face of the earth. And if it won't happen, the Christians will blow up the churches right away. From the time the world would hear the siren of Mashiach, one maximum within an hour or two, there will not be one church and not one mosque in the world. Ask me how. What, Mashiach gonna start running and blowing up churches and mosques? That's what he has to do now after 2,000 years we waited? The answer is no, Mashiach won't have to do it. The Muhammads and the Mustafas will do it, and the Chris and Christine will do it. Why they'll do it? From the embarrassment. It's not JC, the Mashiach. They see a Yemenite Jew come like this, see Saadia. Oh, that's not JC. Or they see a Kurdish guy, or they see a Russian Jew, whatever the Mashiach, whoever the Mashiach is going to be. Oh, what happened to JC? They take away all his picture, right away, put it in a fire, not to leave any souvenir from their nonsense. You know, one Jew and one Arab, they had an argument. Which religion has bigger chachamim, more chachamim in quantity? So they said, you know, for every chacham you have, you pull one hair from my beard, the Jews say to the Mustafa. And Mustafa says, and then when I said chachamim that we have in Judaism, I pull a hair from your beard. So the Arabs say, okay, in one condition that I start. So the Jews say, fine, you start. So Mustafa say to him, Abdallah, he pull one. Mustafa ibn Ibrahim, tak, another one. Ahmed, tak, 10, 20, 30. Oh, 30 beards came out of the thick beard of the Jew. And then the Arab sitting, thinking, he said, okay, that's it, you ran out of names. Okay, now it's my turn, the Jew say. The Jew grab all his beard. Tak, 1 second, he said, this is Rabbi Akiva and his 24,000 Talmidim. Before we even start. Before we start, the Arab became shaved. How many chachamim there? They had chachamim? What chachamim? Anyway, so we move on. So the answer is, the Torah spoke, a person has to be dover emet bilvavo. We say it every morning in a tefillah. It's a very big ma'ala. לעולם יהיה אדם ירא שמיים בסתר כבגלוי ומודה על האמת ודובר אמת בלבבו. תוכו כברו. What's inside, that's what's outside. גמרא עשה, רב ספרא היה דובר אמת בלבבו. This is גמרא in מכות חף דלת. גמרא עשה, רב ספרא, in whatever he had in mind, that's what he did. Even if he was able to change because nobody knows, whatever. If he decided to sell for 10 shekel, that's it, 10 shekel, right? One time the Gemara say was in the middle of Kriyat Shema, and a person came to give him money, and he said, okay, he didn't answer, so he said 20, 30, 40, whatever. By the end, he told him 10. He said, but I already offered you 30. So he said, I was in the middle of Kriyat Shema. You didn't pay attention. I couldn't answer you. I agree already when you say 10. But this is a very big ma'ala. You understand? So this is Rav Safra. Therefore, every one of us should be in this level. However, if you ask if it's allowed or not, why we need to know if it's allowed? If he's able to take the difference away from you. If it's not allowed, he take you to Beit Din. Give me the 20 change. I give you an example. There's a prisoner. He came out of jail. What does it mean? The goyim put him in jail in the border of Turkey and Syria. The Jew is in jail now. He had a little money on him. He bribed the guard to open the gate for 1 minute, a window, to let him run. And he ran, and now he started to run, and he saw a lake. He has to cross the lake. There's one person over there with a boat, and he sees that he's wearing a pajama of a prisoner. He knows what he needs to cross the lake. And this person, this is his job, he's crossing prisoners the lake. And how much he charged? $10 for a ride. But he saw his situation, he told him $100. You know, this is an emergency for him. That's what the airline does to us. The closer you are to the flight, they triple and five times the price of a ticket. Or in a season, when everyone has to go for the holiday, shchita. Blackmail. Bemisgeret achok. According to the law. So the question now, the Jew is going to get caught. They're going to grab him. They're looking for him with dogs now. We hear the dogs coming close. So he gives him 100. He crossed him. He said, okay, I'll give you 100. No problem. Go. He crossed it. Then he gives him 10. He said to him, get lost. So, why? You're a Jew with the yarmulke. You tell me you give me 100. I trusted you. Did he do right or wrong when he gave him only 10 in the end? So that's what you charge everyone. That's what I'm giving you. Or since he say I'm going to give you 100, he has to give him now the 100. The answer is, there is a din in the Gemara, meshate becha. I was fooling you. You cannot tell a person I was fooling you just like that. You can only use this if you have solid, honest reason. You came to steal from me, and you took advantage on my situation. I was forced. It's blackmail. I was forced to give it to you. Now I have a way to get around and not to pay you. I'm giving you what you anyway would agree on. You're charging everyone 10. What? My money is different than anyone? So that's called din meshate becha. The question is, what happened if you already took the money in advance? The owner of the boat said, I'm not giving you before you give me the 100. So he gave him 100. And now he said to him, now when you cross me the river, give me back 90. If not, I call the Jewish police to arrest you and I take you to Beit Din and you have to give me back the change. Can he get the money out of him once he gave it to him or no? We already said that in advance, if he took him, then he doesn't have to give him. He gives him what the right cause. But the question now, what happened if you already gave it? Can you get back change or no? What do you think? Huh? It says like this. The Gemara in Baba Metzia Nun Aleph. The Gemara says, Echad ratza liknot nezamim sheshavim 50. Person wanted to buy jewelry worth 50. Va'amocher darash 60. The seller told him 60, and everybody knows this is a set price 50, but the mocher 60. So he said, but you know what, for you I'm going to do it for 55. The buyer said, no, it's okay, take 60. Why would the buyer offer him 60 after he agreed to give him a discount to go to 55?
15%.
No? 15%. There is a rule. If a person overcharges you 16% on the price, shtut, the Gemara say, you know, shishit, six from 100% is 16%, 16 and a half, in a quarter. So if a person overcharged you by 16%, if you take him to Beit Din, he must give you back the money and take the product back. Must. The Beit Din forced him. If he overcharged you 12%, he keeps the money. But 16% and higher, you can get back the money away from him. So that person needed right away now this nezamim. He's going to use it tonight for the wedding. His wife going to put it, jewelry. Tomorrow he's going to take him to Beit Din and he say, look what he charged me. Look at the receipt, 60, and it was only 50. The real price, the value. So now they must take back the things and give him back the 60. But if we would take 55, it's only 5 more, it's 10% more. Then he wouldn't be able to. Now, Chatan is getting married. Chatan. When? In 3 hours. He come to the barber, said to the barber, in 3 hours is my wedding, look at my hair. The barber took advantage. Where is he going to find another barber? Instead of $15, he told him 50. I'm sorry, short notice, that. 50. Take it or leave it. So he said to him, let me ask you a question, Mr. Barber. I have a problem that you never saw in your life. He said, what? He said, why do you think 3 hours before my wedding I have so much hair? Do you think I'm that dumb that I wait 3 hours before my wedding to find a barber? So he thinks the barber, he said, really, that's very stupid. You Jews are not so stupid. What happened? He said, I have a disease. What's the disease? No matter how many times I take haircut, 3 hours later it goes like this. So the barber start to laugh, you and your jokes. So he said to him, you don't believe me? How about if I come back in 3 hours on my way and I show you how, after the wedding, on my way, I come with my tuxedo, you see how my hair grew up. Would you give me half a price? The barber said, what is this guy's joke? He said, yes. So, okay, let me give you half. The price was 15, so now the price, the barber doubled the price. He wanted 30. So he said, here, give me 15, which is the regular price. Let me give you 15. And I come back in a few hours and I prove to you that my hair grew up. So that's a condition. After the wedding he came back, his hair grew up. True story, it happened in reality. Barber almost fainted. Said to his wife, Sarah, hold me. I'm about to faint. How can it be? I just cut his hair 5 hours ago. No?
Twin brother.
Very good. He had a twin brother. Another zombie like this with afro. So he said to his, Itzik, go to this address. This is the story. Show up. Wear nice suit. Come inside. See, Baruch Hashem, mazal tov. I became a chatan. Look what happened to my hair. Now he's asking the rabbi if he did right or wrong. Because the whole thing was just to pay what he anyway had to pay. Technically, he did nothing wrong. Why? He could have told the barber, okay, take 15 now, and tomorrow I'll come and give you the other 15, and then tomorrow the barber goes, hey, where is the rest of my money? He says, it's not your money, you're a crook. You have a price on a thing, $15, everybody pay 15. You saw me on my way to my wedding, instead of giving it to me for free, you charge me 30, take your 15 and be quiet. He didn't have to make up all the story, my hair grow, my brother. So technically he could get away by this din, meshate becha. The Gemara say, maskana. מותר לגנוב דעתו של מוכר שמרמה ומפקיע מחירים. A seller that cheat on the prices, overpriced, take advantage on people. You're allowed to trick him, like you say, אם נבל תתנבל, to get to the right price. A seller that know he has a stingy customer. Every day he comes to buy something in the store, every week. And he knows he always fighting for the price, give me a discount. Now he already knows his customer. If he doesn't get a discount, he doesn't buy. He goes outside upset. So he's asking, let's say he buys something that's worth 100. If I won't give him a discount, at least 10%, he won't buy. Am I allowed to say that the price is 115, and in the end I lower it to 100, and I sell it to him for what I really wanted to sell him? He feel good, and I got what I want to sell it for. And I'm not cheating him, I'm not stealing from him the price. Everybody else pay 100. But he's a greedy guy. Even if he have millions of dollars, if he doesn't get it on sale, he doesn't feel good. There are people like that. You must take something off. If not, they don't buy for the principal. Allowed or not allowed?
Low fare. Low fare.
Allowed. Why? Because in the end, nobody buys unless he agreed to the price. And we're not talking now that you have a wedding in 2 hours and you must take a haircut. That's taking advantage. Regular. There's hundreds of stores. No one, but go across the street, buy over there. Nobody forces him to buy. This. You tell him 115 because you already know him. But you already have in your mind to give him 100. What happened if today he's sick and he didn't ask for a discount? You already told him 115. And he agreed. And it's not 16% more. It's only 15% more. You allowed or no? You have to tell him, you know what? I'm in a good mood today. I'll give you a discount even though you didn't ask. $100. Then you bought a customer for life. That's it. Before we finish, it says like this. Someone who wants to invest money in a stock market. What are the problems by investing money in a stock market? One, the companies work on Shabbat. Maybe the stock doesn't trade on Shabbat, but those company, McDonald's, you buy McDonald's. They sell non-kosher food. They sell halav u'basar. They open their businesses on Shabbat. And you're a Jew. Once you buy 100 stocks in McDonald's, you became a partner in McDonald's by 0.00001%. But you still became a partner of a business that works on Shabbat. Or interest. Company that charge interest from Jews, Bank of America. They give loans to Jews and they charge them interest. Now you become an owner of the bank, you benefit from the interest that goes to Jews, come from Jews into your pocket. Indirectly, you charge interest from a Jew. All these kind of questions, bottom line, conclusion, are you allowed to buy stocks? The answer is yes. You're allowed. Every one of the dilemmas has a different answer why you're allowed. There's no time. It's going to take me 2 hours to explain. But one thing you're not allowed, stocks that are based on speculation, it's like gambling. Speculations, that it's 50-50 chance. You put $1 million today. If tomorrow they announce that the medicine was productive, it will jump to 2 million. If not, the million will become zero. That's like throwing dice. What's the difference? You go with somebody, okay, let's throw dice. If it's 3 and up, I win the million. If it's 3 below, you win the million. And you throw it. It's like gambling. It's not a business. You buy speculation. Options, I'm not an expert in options. I don't know exactly the concept, how it works. Someone explained it to me. I heard it from a few different people, and everyone explained it different. That's why I'm confused a little bit what it means. But I know that it's based on lots of gambling here. But at least over there, it's a period of time, how the company performs. And so, you know, it's depend on sales in here. We are now talking one speculation. If they will say good or they will say bad, it's like putting the money on this rooster or on that rooster. Stocks like that, speculative stocks. Maybe it's better to delete this question from the shiur because it's obviously much more complicated than answer yes or no. But in general, we got the point. General stocks we're allowed to buy, even though there's some dilemmas. Each one of those dilemmas were answered by the poskim why it's allowed. I go to a bookstore and I read over there in a store, even though I have no intention to buy the book. Am I allowed to do so or no? I can't afford to buy books. So I come to the store every once in a while, I open, I read here, I read there. Or if I need book in Igmara, and I don't have it, so I go to the bookstore, I read the answer over there, I close it, I do it, and to, you know, am I allowed to do it or not? Oh, bookstore, it's not a library. If everyone would come to do his homework there for free, he won't be able to sell one book. After a week, all the books will be used. However, bookstores give sample. They put on a table or in an area that you can go and they make a separate library to come and taste. Just like the grocery man give you some pistachios for free. You take one or two. If you want to take after two more, he gets angry. He hits you on the head. Why? They all taste the same. Don't take. You know? So the point is, what they offer for the public, they already know that this book is finished. They won't be able to sell it. It's for general use, then you're allowed. But if it's on a books for sale, on a shelf, not allowed. Am I obligated by the Torah to give tip to the waiters? Waiter, the gas man that put gas by you. You're allowed to give him tip on. I'm not talking now Kiddush Hashem, Chilul Hashem. That if you give him and you see with Yamaka, you earn Kiddush Hashem. And if you don't give him and you see with Yamaka, it becomes Chilul Hashem. I'm talking as a gratitude. Is this something that I'm obligated or not? Let's assume he doesn't see Yamaka. I go with a baseball hat. He doesn't know I'm a Jew. No Chilul Hashem, no Kiddush Hashem. Am I obligated between me and Hashem to give the guy over there in the gas station tip or the waiter who served me the food? Am I obligated or not? The answer, if it's the custom in that location to do so, it becomes an obligation. Minhag ha-makom. I'm a boss of a company and one of my employees leaves, retired, quit, whatever, doesn't feel good, cannot work anymore, got old, many reasons to quit. Or I want to let him go. I'm not happy anymore from his performance. Do I have to pay him compensation? Or I say, it was nice meeting you. Here, take some chocolate and get out of my face. Allowed or not allowed? Or I must pay him compensation?
That is the law of the country.
Do we have anywhere in the Torah that you have to pay compensation?
Where? Release a slave.
Where?
Slave.
By slaves. But who's to say that a slave and a waiter has the same din? He can learn a little bit the idea, but he cannot learn ledamot. Slave is slave. And a servant, I mean a waiter, it's a one-time service. It's a different story. The answer is the same thing, minhag ha-makom. If the rule in this country, this government, or this state, that the law does not require that, it's up to your good heart or not, goodwill. Then you decide if you want to give or not. But if minhag ha-makom, the custom of that state, the custom of that country, is to give X amount for how many years he worked, usually in most places it's 1 month out of a year, usually. Which means if he worked for you 10 years, what is his monthly salary? Let's say he makes $2,000 a month, the worker, multiply by 10 years that he works, you have to give him $20,000 and goodbye. If you tell him, listen, I'm very tight right now, can I give you such an amount of money? So if you quit, I will only give you 10 if you don't mind. And he agreed, that's no problem. He didn't steal from him, he agreed. But if he insists to get the 20 and that's the minhag ha-makom, you have to give it to him. And if he'll take you to Din Torah, they'll force you to pay it. Why? Minhag ha-makom. So if somebody ever come and say, where does it say in the Torah you have to give pitzuim? The answer, minhag ha-makom. There are thousands of laws, by the way, that in Bet Din, they'll judge us as minhag ha-makom. If there's no source in the Torah, they will answer, what's minhag ha-makom? It gets to such minhag ha-makom that, if I remember correctly, the Ben Ish Chai said that women without shoes and without socks, it's no problem with tzniut. Why? Because in the Arab countries, many people used to walk barefoot. And since it was a common thing, every other woman walks without shoes, nobody looks at the feet of a woman. But today, when everyone has shoes, if a woman would walk without shoes, it would be something that nobody ever heard of. What? She walks in the street with barefoot like that? So right away, it attracts attention to her legs. That's not going to be allowed. But if it's in Baghdad, everyone is like that, let's say 100 years ago. It doesn't become a matter of modesty. You understand? By the way, that reflects about covering the hair. You can ask the same thing. Okay, so there's minhag ha-makom, nobody covers the hair. What's the difference? The answer is, the law of modesty requires that a woman would cover her legs below the knees. Anything from the knee to the thing, it's not erva. It's extra. It's chumrah. Therefore, when it comes to chumrot, then you go by minhag ha-makom. But if minhag ha-makom violate a rule from the Torah above the knee or the hair, which is the oraita, we don't care at all about minhag ha-makom. What do we care about minhag ha-makom? We only care what the Torah says. The Torah comes before minhag ha-makom. The only time we're going to say minhag ha-makom when there's no clear rule by the Torah. The Torah did not speak about it. Or Shulchan Aruch did not speak about it. Something new. Something that came out now. You know, like zchuyot yotzrim. If a person has kinyan ruchani. It's dina de malchuta. Dina de malchuta. Most governments say you're not allowed to copyrights, break copyrights. It's in FBI, Interpol, warning, all kinds of things like this. It's minhag ha-makom. If someone would sue you, they'll go by minhag ha-makom. If you can get away with that, that's a different story, because you did not violate any rule of the Torah. But if there's a chance you get caught, then it's already you're binded to do minhag ha-makom. But it's very complicated, and also it's big machlokot between aposkim when it comes to zchuyot yotzrim. Some of the poskim write in their book that it's not allowed, but if you ask them in person, they tell you it's allowed. Why? They don't want to go to jail. What are they going to write? That you're allowed to copy CDs from things without buying it? You're allowed to burn it? What are they going to write it in a book? What's going to happen the next day? The United States government will come to him and say, hey, you know, as a leader of a community, they're going to start finding all kinds of excuses to make you a problem. In Israel, even worse. They're not crazy about you as it is with your hat and your beard. So if you're going to write something like this, first of all, it will be all over the newspapers. Tomorrow morning, already the IRS would come to drink coffee with you. You understand? Now, the next thing. Not much time is running out, so just we conclude this chapter. Are we allowed to give the customer samples for free that he will get used to it and addicted to it, that now he becomes a customer? No. You know, one Israeli guy came to New York for the first time 20, 30 years ago. It's a true story. He came to New York, so he went, you know, and he wanted to drink Turkish coffee. But there's no Turkish coffee in New York. There was no Black Bus. What's their name? Starbucks. There's no Starbucks, none of these companies. So he asked his Moroccan friend, said to him, tell me, where can I get the Turkish coffee over here? He said to him, you're in America. The coffee here is water with brown color. You don't have. So he said, come on, I'm addicted to coffee. He said, there's one coffee that is very, very similar, it's very strong. It's called espresso. Okay, order it for me. He said to the waiter, to my friend, please bring espresso. She bring a little glass like this. This Moroccan Jew. Shouted, okay, yeah, you can bring me like that. It's good. He told it's simple. She said, that's the drink. I was in Istanbul. They bring the coffee in a very small ceramic white glasses like this. So strong. This little one is stronger than the whole thing that we drink. And when we think, it's so strong, in my opinion, the Israeli coffee, Turkish coffee, is much better taste than what the original Turkish coffee. But this is the way they serve it. They bring it like this on a plate, small like this, and they have some kind of a spice inside. I don't know what they put. Whatever. Okay, now we move on. So the question, are you allowed or no? The answer, if it's not mandatory, you're not allowed. It's called in English endorsement effect. It's a psychological way to connect a person to an object by making him addicted to it. So it's basically deceiving him. I'll give you an example. One time in America, there's a company was selling food for dogs. And when they made a commercial on television 30 years ago, all the dogs in America came to the screen, standing on two feet, and they go crazy. Then when they see the food, every proud American that loves his dog more than his kids, when he see now the dogs likes these cans of food, what do you think happened? He doesn't even wait for tomorrow, right away he order. In the old days, there's no credit card, call, buy one now, 30 days trial. They didn't have all these tricks. So they tell you the location where you can get it, Walmart. He runs right away, he buys his dog the food, the dog eats. This company made fortune. After years, they found out that it was a scam. What's the scam? Inside the commercial, they made a beep, a signal that only dogs heard. The frequency of the signal, a person cannot hear it. It's calling the dog. Yeah, all kinds of things. It makes them curious what it is. So they all come. They think they love the food. In reality, they are wondering where this noise come from. And they made it against the law in America. It's deceiving the customers. Deceiving the customers. One time there's an Israeli psychic. He goes on television and he said to the listeners, hundreds of thousands of people on prime time, when we come back from commercial, he's going to say, I want each one of you to pick up a number. When we come out from commercials, I'm going to tell which number you picked. How can you tell hundreds of thousands of people which number they picked? It can be thousands of options. He came back over, I'm looking at this commercial, and I picked up a number. And then he came back, and he said, the number that you all picked up is 23. I said, wow, how can it be? See, number 23, I said, I picked up 23. All the people, I also picked up 23. 23, 23, how can it be? It has to be a scam here, but well. Now he show how he did the trick. He was standing in a market in Jerusalem or Tel Aviv, I don't remember, when hundreds of people walk behind him on the street. And they interview him, there's a camera, and people walk behind him. In the exact second when he said, I want each one of you to pick up a number, one guy went with a T-shirt, Michael Jordan, number 23, on his shirt. We did not pay attention, but the subconscious, which is the soul, absorbed the information without us being aware. And that second that he said picked up a number, it went into our brain, number 23. This is a revolution, if you understand what I just said to you. This is, by the way, one of the stronger proof that the Torah is emet. Because the Torah says, what goes inside, it cannot be deleted. That's it. There's no way to delete it. Even a person made tshuva. Whatever he saw in his life when he was secular, it's there. Cannot delete it. No, there's no such thing to delete it from your head. Computer, you can delete it, that's it. You do search, it doesn't come. It's not in the brain of the computer anymore. It's not on the hard drive. Well, what's in the head, there's no such thing. You may forget, but it's still there. your friend will remind you the beginning right away. You know what he's talking about. Hey, you know me? No, I'm not sure. I was in your house for Shabbat. When I came with you, now all of a sudden you remember the whole show. It's not that you didn't know. You knew, but you just forgot. But it's there. This is lo tatuu acharei levavchem v'acharei enechem asher atem zonim acharem. Even the hypnotized people, they describe things from their previous life, before they're born. They speak in different languages and they describe their previous life, things that they used to do. It's still recorded in the neshama. It's a different brain. When he was in a different body 150 years ago, it wasn't this brain. It was a different brain, different body, different brain, different country. No? How does he still remember things? We say it's in a brain, but it was a different brain. You replaced the brain. You had it in this laptop, now you have a different laptop. How does laptop know what you had in this laptop? Cannot be. The neshama, Habibi. It's all recorded in the neshama. There's no such thing brain. What is a brain? Brain is a steak. What is it? Go to the butcher, pick up a piece of meat. That's the brain. What is it? In this meat, you can load millions of telephone numbers. You can load scenarios, scenes, memory, Torah, Masachtot. Where? You can put it in a piece of meat. Where exactly the information would be? Between the fat and the bone? Where? Of course it's the soul. That's what it is. Time basically ran out. And two last questions and we're done because we just finished the chapter. Am I allowed to go to shoes to measure, to try on shoes, knowing I'm buying it in a different place? I just want to choose. And then after I know the model and the name, the brand, I'm going to tell my son, bring me this model from where you are, which is no taxes over there, or maybe it's a cheaper state. So I'm going to try it in the store. No chance that I'll buy it here. I'll buy it somewhere else. But I want to just try it here, or I'm going to order it online. But I want to see it in my own eyes. So first I come to the store, I try it on. Beautiful. Now I know what to order. Allowed or not allowed?
Allowed
if you tell them in advance that you're not going to buy. There is a way around it. You can say, I want, for religious reason, I want to try it on, but I already tell you that there is a chance that I won't buy it. You say, oh, it's okay, go ahead. If you tell them I won't buy it for sure, they may not agree. But if it's enough, you tell them there's a chance I won't buy it, and they agree, they already take it to consideration that you're not going to buy it, and they still agree. You tell them for sure I won't buy it, it's kind of chutzpah. Also chilul Hashem. So it's better you come. So you say, okay, well, what's the big deal? We know most customers don't buy. It's like Yush. They know. 100 customers, 20 will buy, 80 will not buy. It's a part of business. Actually, they may even admire you for being so honest. But depend. If you get an angry guy, when I was a kid, there was a guy in the neighborhood. He had a kiosk, a little shop. So I used to go, after I used to save coins, a little bit, I had enough to buy Israeli ice cream, So I used to go, so he's behind the counter and the little refrigerator is on the other side, across. So the customer has to pick up the ice cream and then he comes to pay. A kid, he looks, which one should I take? I have only for one. They all look delicious. So sometimes I pick up one, I come, now he takes a piece of newspaper, he's about to wrap it. So I said, no, I want to change it. The look he used to give, you will never ever dare to change your mind in his store ever again. I'll never forget the face of the guy. What a face he used to make. Why? All your crime is, you wanted to put the ice cream back and take a different one. He gave such a look. And sometimes he just couldn't hold himself. He started to scream, enough, don't come here. And the next day you come, and the whole story again. But if you have an owner of a store like this, you don't want to tell him, I may not buy. You may not be able to try the shoes on. You know, they had a joke. He used to be a prime minister of Israel, Yitzhak Rabin. Remember him or no? Got killed. Yeah, so one time he came to New York, and they told him, Yitzhak, maybe we buy you shoes made in Italy, over here there's good prices. So they took him to Manhattan, to the store, so the person over there said, oh, the prime minister, very nice to serve you. So he said, what size you are? So he told him, he says, 9. So the seller said, hold on, I'll be right back. He went to the back, and he brings the box. By the time he came back, he said, 1.5. he used to speak in very slow motion. We will try to make peace with the Palestinian. That's how he used to talk. So they made a joke. But that was a joke. But something really happened with him that sounds even like a bigger joke, but it really happened. They brought him to the Syrian shuls, one of the shuls, and they gave him aliyah for Shabbat. He was a visitor in the shuls. Out of respect, they wanted to give him aliyah la Torah. So he came up to the Torah, and this Halabi, Chazan, he say, Yeah, mi sheberach avotenu Avraham Yitzchak v'Yaakov, hu yivarech et Yitzchak ben? So he say, ben 70. So he said, no, Abba. He said, Abba niftar lifnei 20 shana. The father passed away 20 years ago. He didn't know the concept that you have to say the name of your parent. This is the face of the Jewish nation. The top Jew in the land that never got aliyah to the Torah in his life to know that you do Misha Barach and you have to say the name of your parents. This is where we live in. Ay, 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 ay. Okay, so the answer is you have to tell them in advance. People ask today if they're allowed to buy German products, Mercedes, BMW, Grunding, all kinds of electronic made in Germany. Allowed or not allowed? The answer, very not recommended to support companies that help Hitler to kill our grandparents. Just a simple common sense. It's no law. No law say that you're not allowed. You bought a German product, no one can take you to Beit Din. Perhaps when we come in front of Hashem, perhaps he won't even be mentioned in our trial. But out of a matter of common sense, if now you can go and buy something from the Palestinian that kill us every day and every night, or you can kill it from, you buy it from a Jew, and you go and buy it from the murderers, what the people would think about you in the land? That you're a trader. All you wanted is to save money. They still look at you as a trader. Even though they'll do the same thing to save money. But right now, you're the one who bought it, they cannot look at you. They don't want to sit near you in the shul. Why? He buy from Mustafa's, from the Hamas. So the answer is very not recommended. If I go to a store and the owner offer me to pay cash and he won't charge me tax if I don't ask for receipt, am I allowed to agree? It's his problem that he cheats the government from taxes, or it becomes my problem also, Mesayeh Aledvar Avera. Mesayeh Aledvar Avera, it's not from the Oraita, it's the Rabbanan. Lifnei Iver Lo Titen Michshol, it's the Oraita. Mesayeh Aledvar Avera, it's the Rabbanan. Am I allowed to participate? What do I play dumb? I pay less. In Israel, it's critical, it's 18%. Here it's 8%, everyone cry. In Israel it's 18%, it's a big thing. You buy something that costs $1,000, $180. Allowed or not allowed? If you help the thief to steal, you become a thief yourself. What if I bought and I didn't know? Do I have an obligation to go back and say, make me a receipt, I'll give you extra the tax to correct it? Or what's done, done, since this is a rabbinical restriction? I better not answer it. Now we're going to have to start go to 1,000 stores now. Where are we going to find them all?
But some stores, they say, including the tax. I'll pay you tax for you. So there's
not... Do you know an owner of a store that will pay the tax for you? Show me this guy. They don't pay the tax for you.
Okay, well, they pay, but they pay tax for you. They're a furniture store.
Do we have a preference to buy from Jews than from the Goyim, or no? Or whoever you want to buy from, buy from. When you go to buy something, do you have to search for a Jewish owner to help your brothers? Now, we're not talking racism or things, don't get me wrong. We're just talking, I have my brother as a store and my friend as a store. Do I have an obligation to buy from my brother to give him parnasa, or I can buy from the stranger? The answer, yes. You have to buy from your brother. Your physical brother, if not him, so your Jewish brother, Amitecha, it's include every Jew in the nation. But if there is more than 16% difference on the price, you don't have to. If he's a crook, he overpriced, Yatsa Miklal Amitecha. You can buy it from Mustafa and Baya. Multi-level marketing. Is it kosher to participate in such a thing, or it's a scam? Why it's the question? Because usually the people on the top of the pyramid make a lot of money. Second, third, fourth, fifth, until one day, no more people coming in, and the last wave that came in lose all the money. So it's basically, it's like the coin that I said before. Somebody gave you a fake coin, so you transfer it to Reuven, who transfer it to Shimon, to Yitzchak, to Avram, to Yaakov, and then he got it to one guy, and he got stuck with that. They discover it. Maybe they changed the coin, and now it doesn't look the same. Oh, it's Canadian, it's not American. Until now, it was similar. Now they changed the dollar, you can see. Do you know why they keep changing the American dollars? They changed it in the last 10 years twice. Because of the drug dealers. The drug dealers, they have billions of dollars in cash in rooms that they collect from all the drugs that they're selling. They cannot put it in a bank. Because right away, they will get the IRS involved and the FBI, and the next thing, they'll be in jail for the rest of their life. So they do all their transaction in cash, and they store the cash in rooms. Like they caught this cartel Mexican now with billions of dollars in his home. You saw the pictures? Rooms the size of this big shul, tons of money from the floor to the top, tons, shelves, like you go in a store, you have shelves, everything, there's no way, boxes like this, full of cash, every closet they open, cash, trucks, full of cash, they don't know what to do with this, there was enough cash over there to buy half of the country, one guy, cannot put it in a bank, if now they change the money, he has X amount of time to get rid of all these billions, and he can't. After a few years, he comes out of the system. That's what they did in Israel a few times also. Shekel, and then Shekel Chadash. All the money laundering stopped. It's a very smart trick. You store. The question is, why these crooks and criminals are so dumb? Why are they collecting and accumulating so much? They know in a few years they're going to change it. It happened once, it happened twice. Every few years they do it. So what's the point of all these drug dealers that they put billions of dollars in cash in storages instead of giving it tzedakah, giving it to the poor? Anyway, it's going to go to a waste. From here you see what Yetzer Hara is. He rather lose it. In the end it becomes toilet paper than to feed the poor or to give it to the good things. Not that I justify being a crook or a drug dealer and take the money and give it to tzedakah. No. Lechatchila, of course, it's not kosher. But if you already have $1 billion, and in 1 year they're going to change the print of the dollar, you're going to get stuck with so much money, you're not going to be able to get replacement. Because we can go to the bank, give the bank $10,000 in old bill, and the bank give you brand new ones, and they give it to the government. How are you going to come to the bank with $1 billion cash? What's going to happen? They call Obama from his sleeping to come to see it. It's an alert. It's going to be a disaster. Interesting how they keep doing it. They keep doing it. In the end, they change it, and they get stuck with all this money. There's nothing you can do with that after a while. The more time gone by, nobody wants to take old bills. Here and there, they push one. They give you $10,000, they push 10. They try to get rid of it, but they have a billion to get rid of. It's very difficult. But you cannot give a person $10,000 in cash and all of them in old bills. He's not going to want to take it. You don't understand. Today it's too short because it's only a few years. But after 20 years, if somebody will give you the old bill, 10,000 old bills, you're not going to want to take it. As of now, the bank's still taking it. But from a bunch, 2-3%, the bank will take it because it's normal. It's leftover. But if you come to the bank now with $100,000 in old bills, I promise you, tomorrow morning, the FBI will be in your home. Guarantee. You understand? But if you do it with other things, they make you fill up tax papers. No problem. But if you're going to bring so much old bills, tomorrow morning, your phone will be tapped. The FBI will get a warrant, and they will start watching every step you do. Why? Logically. The drug dealers don't get it. Why Hashem fooled them like that? Because there's no bracha in this money. Killing children and making money, you can enjoy X amount of years. In the end, it costs big time. Everything kosher, there's bracha in the money. Everything that is not in a kosher way, soon or later, atid adan litet din v'cheshbon hazeh. If not now, in 20 years from now. If not in 20 years, in the next life. Is a person will pay for what he did. He got it in the wrong way. It's just a matter of time until the time will come to start paying for what he did wrong. No one get away with anything. And there's no way to do tshuva on money issues. The only way to do tshuva on money issues is to return the stolen money and to fix the damage. Any other thing, you didn't put tefillin, it's between you and Hashem. You do tshuva, fixed. You didn't eat kosher. You do tshuva, fixed. Even Shabbat, you get some suffering, fixed. Money issues, you cannot make tshuva without the person that you hurt. No way. There's no way. You can be the biggest tzaddik in the world. You can become Gdol Ador in Torah. You're still a criminal. Why? You owe people money. You left the world when you owe money to people. There's no chance for you to go to Gan Eden. Nobody that has stolen money in his hand can enter Gan Eden, and definitely not Olam Haba. Stealing requires Gilgul. Some sins, a person can go to Gehenom for X amount of time and get clean. And then he goes to Gan Eden. Stealing, you must come back here to pay. Because in Gehenom, who are you going to pay the money back? The only way to correct it is giving back the money to the original owner. And in Gehenom, even if you and him will be there, you still cannot give him the money because over there money doesn't have issue. You must come back to this world and pay him back the money to his end. Like the Ari writes in Shara Gilgulim and in other stories about the Ari, that sometimes a partner who steals from his partner, Hashem brings them back as a husband and wife. And they get divorced, and he gives her $1 million or $2 million for the ketubah. And he feels bad for the next 20 years. He want to kill her. How she took advantage on me. If I could, I'd kill her. It would be better off. Why didn't I kill her? And one day he died, and Hashem say, you fool, that's your ticket to heaven. What? To pay this wicked woman is a ticket for heaven? This wicked woman who is your ex-partner from your previous life that you stole from him $2 million in 20 years. You came to this world. You got married for 2 years. In 2 years, you gave her $2 million from the marriage settlement, and that's returning the money that you stole in a previous life when you were in two different bodies. It's very hard to understand, but that's the only way to return. So why stealing? Let's manage with what Hashem gives us. Let's not go to the restaurant and order by the stomach. You understand? I'm for the opposite. Let's not order by the eyes. Let's order by the stomach. The stomach can have half a pound of food. If you're a big guy, 1 pound of food. That's it. Why you order 15 plates? This and that and 2 pita and dessert. What for? Anyway, you're not going to eat a third of it. The ta'ava, the kina, the kavod, מוציאים את האדם מן העולם. Check all the people in a history that lost their עולם הבא, it's one of the three reasons. קנאה, תאווה and כבוד. All of them. Check. Either it's jealousy or ego issues and stuff like that, כבוד, or desires. קנאה, תאווה, desires. Women, money, taking the person. Why a person מחלל שבת? Business, money, or desire, pleasure. This, that, driving, going, shopping. So that's desire. Why a person kill another person? Either money or ego, כבוד. Any one of the things that makes a person lose his eternity, put the point on it, either קנאה, תאווה, and כבוד, like Chazal told us. הקנאה והתאווה והכבוד מוציאים את האדם מן העולם. We see today what's happening in the politics. What's going on? Unbelievable. Never been in such a horrible situation. Not, you cannot find today almost not one politician that is clean. It wasn't like this 50 years ago. In the old days, secular politicians were not crooks and thieves. They were not religious, but Menachem Begin, alav shalom. It wasn't exactly a rabbi, but for sure he didn't steal. There used to be decent people when it comes to integrity. But one generation later, we did not have one person left honest, even with yarmulke on. Forget about secular. That's what's going on today. Even people that are supposed to be big tzaddikim, everyone here, this, that, changing the Torah according to the convenience. What's going on? Mi ya'aleh be'har Hashem, no wonder that the Navi said, the big test before Mashiach would come, it's money. What is mi ya'aleh be'har Hashem? Chazal explained who's going to get to inherit Olam Haba. Mi ya'aleh be'har Hashem, neki kapayim ubar levav. Someone that his hand is clean and his heart is clean. No ego, no desire, no jealousy, no stealing, no cheating, no deceiving. Ooh, it could be a big Shomer Shabbat, learning, Steigen, like this. Mashiach come, will give you such a smack, will make you fly to India. Why? But I finished Shas 3 times. Push the Shas into your mouth and stuff you and choke you with that. Why? You're the biggest criminal. You finished Shas 3 times. Look at this Jew. Look at him sitting, cleaning shoes. Never stole a dollar in his life. He's much better than you. He didn't learn almost all his life nothing. A little bit dafyomi from the rabbi. He comes in Arabic, in Persian. He learned a little bit every day. Honest. Never stole, never hurt people, never murdered people. And you with all the steigen, destroying massive amount of people. You know Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky. You know Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky, the short rabbi, he passed away about a year ago. Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky, when he came to Israel, it was an incredible darshan, and a big Tamid Chacham, and apparently a big tzaddik also. So there's an incredible story with Rabbi Yaakov Galinsky. One time, he went to Siberia. The Russians, everyone they didn't like, they sent to Siberia in horrible, horrible torture. When he was in Siberia, they gave him soup. That was the daily meal, soup. So he was eating a soup, and next to him there was a Jew that is hungry. And his name was Chulev. Chulev, that was the name of that Jew. He sat next to him and looking at him how he eats the soup. This is survivor war. Less soup, you can be dead tomorrow. Not like today. Okay, put the soup to go. That soup could be the only thing you're going to eat until tomorrow afternoon. But he saw a Jew is hungry and he looks at him like that. So he gave him half of his soup. So I couldn't eat when I see a Jew hungry next to me. I just couldn't eat. So he gave him half of the soup. And that was the story. Many years later, he came to Israel and he was close to the Chazon Ish, Zecher Tzadik Livracha. The Chazon Ish one time told him, the Zionist communist, they put all the Sfaradim children in camps in Israel when they came. They made them all kinds of like a camping place until they decide what to do with them. And that camps, it's they teach them Russian songs, men and women together, boys and girls. They teach them all kinds of things that from the communist. And of course, they don't teach Torah. They teach the opposite of the Torah. They want to make them secular. So the Chazon Ish wanted to save these Sfaradi kids. So the Chazon Ish told to Rav Yaakov Galinsky, I want you to go into this camp and ask the parents of these kids, find out the list of the parents, and ask them who wants to take his kids out of this camp that we send them to Yeshivot and we will raise them. Because the parents were very naive, Sfaradi, Yemenite, Moroccan, Persian, they didn't know anything from their life. They came to Israel, finally the dream came through after 2,000 years. They didn't know that the plan over there is to make Israel a Russian state, communist, anti-Torah. They didn't know. They felt Jews. They put the kids over there. What could they do with them? No Talmud Torah to put them. So what happened is, Rav Yaakov Galinsky came over there, but he was surrounded with fence. And there's a guard. Cannot come in. So he asked the Chazon Ish, what should we do? So the Chazon Ish told him, make a hole, dig a hole in the ground, and go under the hole, just like the fox doing. When they come to hunt the chicken, they make a hole underground, and they go underneath. So as they were doing it, they got caught. They had Shin Gimel, patrol. They caught him. He went with another rabbi. They caught him, and of course they beat them up, and they brought them into a room, and they're waiting for the commander to come. After, they tied them to a chair. They couldn't move. So they keep saying, wait until Chulev would come and he will take care of you real good. Then Rav Yaakov Galinsky say, where do I know this name Chulev from? Where do I know this name Chulev? It wasn't a common name. Then it came to his mind that this Chulev is the person he gave him a soup. He said, oh, Ezrat Hashem, I hope it's the same one. All of a sudden, he came, big gangster like this, not religious, not nothing. He came in, Chulev, was ready to break their bones. So he said to him, Rav Yaakov Galinsky, told him, remember Siberia, 19, whatever the year was? He looks at him, say, yes. Say, remember me, look at me, I'm small, you cannot make mistake. Very short. I gave you my soup. So right away, from being a big enemy, right the way he hugged him. It was a very exciting moment for him. So Rav Yaakov Galinsky took him to the side. He told him, now, since Baruch Hashem, we got together after all these years, can I ask you a favor? He asked him, what are you doing here? You're breaking into the place. Your rabbis are not supposed to do things like this. He told him, there's a reason why we came here. He said, tell your people behind, you know, this is all the people were his soldiers. He's the general there. He said, I need you a favor. I want you to give me a list of the parents of all these kids, where they are, where can I find them. I want to make them sign on a paper that they give me their kids for adoptions. That we take them and we teach them Torah. Now remember, this Chulev is anti-Torah. He's a communist. So he's saying, okay, you're asking too much. I mean, fine, you gave me soup. But you're asking for a lot more. But his gratitude to Galinsky was so big for the story, how he was starving, and it was such an act of appreciation. I mean, like, who would give you, when people are starving to death, to give you half of the meal to a stranger? He couldn't tell him no. He said, okay, come tomorrow morning, I have the list for you. And then he made him the list, and how many Sfaradi kids got saved from destroying their souls for eternity? 65 kids got saved from half a bowl of soup. You understand how far it goes, the mitzvot? Now this 65 could be today 10,000 Jews Shomrei Torah mitzvot. Some of the bigger rabbis in the world is thanks to that soup. And Rav Yaakov Galinsky now in Gan Eden, how much he's earning for that half a bowl of soup? Think about it. Huh? Incredible. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen. Rabbi Hananiah ben Akashia.